Welcome to our evening meeting. This one should be very interesting. We have two apologists who will be addressing you from their two different viewpoints, maybe the same viewpoint. So we'll see. But it's always interesting for us as former Adventists to hear how Christians who have studied Adventism, who've never been Adventists, how they see us, how they see our former religion, and just the truths about what we came from their maybe non-jaded viewpoint. So it's a good evening to be here. In the meantime, Kit Satry, who is a neighbor of ours, is going to... Sorry, Pastor Wollins. Has an announcement.
Hi, I did recently get married to my wonderful husband, Pastor Wollins, and he's a senior pastor at a Higher Ground Calvary Chapel Church in Riverside, and he came and Colleen and Richard came over and met with all the pastors over there, and he's really interested in helping the community understand kind of the truth and lies of what we were told as Adventists. And so there's an event that's going to be taking place at his church in Riverside on March 5th at 5 p.m. And for those that are here, there's a little flyer about it, and we always provide food at each of the places. But the address is on the back of it and stuff. And this isn't to just bash the Adventists and talk smack about them. At the top it says, a path to truth or deception, a quest for truth. And ultimately that's what we're helping people sort out. So that night we're going to have a panel, and Colleen and Richard will be on the panel, some Q&A kind of stuff. But you're welcome to come, or if you know other people in that area or people that are just kind of searching, please share this with them, and they're welcome to come to that event.
Thank you, Kit. Also, Carl and Nikki Stevenson will be joining us there. And I think maybe some others. I'm not sure yet. Anyway, it's a great opportunity to come out to Riverside and join your brothers and sisters at a church there. So tonight, Paul Carden and... Jim Baber. But first, let's worship our Lord.
To be with you all, let's stand to praise our God.
The Lamb of all.
This is a newer song you may not know, but I really, really love it. It's energetic and so upbeat and positive, and it's singing about the King of Love, our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's sing together. This last song has been kind of an anthem, at least I view it as such, and we're going to have two apologists now, and so I think it's a great, really very fitting to speak about the church rising up and to defend the truth, and so we're the body of Christ here, and we're rising up to defend the truth about Christ. So let's sing together.
Reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. On every side, we know the outcome is secure, and Christ will love, the Christ will win. lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day, every eye and heart shall see him. So Spirit, come, put strength in every stride, give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old sail line the way, retelling triumphs of his grace, we hear the calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory. As saints of old sail line the way, retelling triumphs of his grace, we hear the calls and hunger for the day when with Christ we stand in glory.
Thank you, Kaspars and Roy. You can go ahead and do that. It's really amazing when two apologists spend time believing us, believing what we as former Adventists say about our former religion, and they take us seriously, and then they study it and make sure we're actually telling the truth. So these two men have spent years looking at Adventism. They didn't start with Adventism as their main goal to study, but they've been doing it for years now. Paul Carden, I had the privilege of serving on his ministry board for quite a few years. Got to know him and his team, and a great team of men who love the true gospel and love seeing it passed around the world. He's the executive director of the Centers for Apologetics Research. And that is a cult-related research ministry that has centers in different parts of the world, places that where Adventism is making big inroads. And so it's a really good thing when Paul takes Adventism seriously. He served for 6 years in Brazil, and he was... He actually worked with Walter Martin, the late great Walter Martin, and also served as co-host for the Bible Answer Man radio broadcast back in the day. And we're just thankful, Paul, you're here. And then after him, we will hear from Jim Baber. And he's been a Christian only since 1990. Doesn't seem like that long for me. But soon after he became a Christian, he began studying Jehovah's Witnesses, but then he branched out and started looking at all the major groups like Seventh-day Adventist, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, Church of Christ, Islam, Christadelphians, Children of God. There's a lot of groups that, new religions that have veered from or not even been part of the true Christian church. He also is involved in on-street evangelism. That takes extra nerve, I gotta say. And he also, what really caught our attention was his online evangelism. He does really great videos on Adventism, very well researched and full of, I mean, he puts down references and it's very, very good. So, we're really pleased that he's joining us. This is his first time speaking at this conference, though he's been with us at the conference for many years. So these two men have something to say, and so I'm looking forward to hearing what they have to say. And then afterwards, we will have our famous Q&A. So, Paul, did this get put up?
Ooh, that's really good.
Right there?
Yes. It's not going to topple. Thank you. Good evening. I'm not accustomed to doing this laptop screeny thing, you know? So I hope this works out. So I think that everyone present in this room can agree that Seventh-day Adventism is a growing problem. Over 22 million members worldwide as of last June, and some other statistics to give you some context. In 2021, there were just over 1 million accessions. I assume most of you know what that means. That means new members, converts. That does not include births. Over 1 million. That averages out to one accession every 30 seconds or so. One new congregation every 3.62 hours. And at the same time, and I'm sure this will also be of interest to you, in 2021, there were almost 800,000 losses, which equals people leaving. That does not include deaths. Over the past 15 years, the rate of net losses is about 42%. Is that something to celebrate? Or, in truth, are many of these people, perhaps even most, Adventized and spiritually damaged and confused and in need of rescue themselves, even though they have walked away? Now, for me as a missionary, and Richard alluded to this, I take special note of the following numbers. In 2021, the top 20 countries in terms of Adventist membership made up nearly 75% of the world total. Three quarters in just 20 countries. 11 of those top 20 countries are in sub-Saharan Africa. And amazingly, those 11 countries, their membership makes up nearly 40% of the world total. So my real world challenge, my day-to-day challenge, as I help believers in Kenya and Uganda and Zambia and Malawi and so forth, is how can we best persuade Christians in Africa that Adventism is so biblically unsound that its false teachings need to be firmly rejected and its followers need to be evangelized? Because Adventism has a rather high reputation in these countries where it is so well established and growing at such a clip. You see, I've learned in 40-some years of going to Eastern Southern Africa, lay African Christians don't do nuance well. They just want to know, is it true or is it false? Is it a cult or isn't it? And not a lot in between is satisfying to them. Now, we have a problem because Adventism is the duckbill platypus of Christianity. It defies easy categorization. And Adventists' attitudes toward us, what do you call it? Is it schizophrenia? Is it gaslighting? One minute they want to sing Kumbaya with all the Protestants, and the next minute, they're the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and Sunday worship is the mark of the beast observed by Babylon and her harlot daughters. Which is it to be? Depends, doesn't it? Which brings me to a dilemma that we face sometimes, not only in Africa, but here in the United States. How do we best label this growing problem called Adventism? Because whatever label we choose, we want to be taken seriously by two distinct audiences. Outsiders, which is to say non-Adventists, in which case our objective is to warn and explain, and Adventists, in which case our objective is to evangelize. As a practical matter, for the purposes of this talk, I want to focus on persuading outsiders, that is, uninformed and frequently skeptical Christians. What label do we use? Option one, denomination. Even most Adventists seem to be just fine with this. Definitely not an inflammatory word. Option number two, new religious movement. Not widely applied to the Adventists, as it seems rather improbable. 169 years old equals new, but scholars such as Irving Hexham have used it. This too is not inflammatory. It might have someone scratching their heads, but they won't get angry. Option three, sect. From the Latin secta, meaning party or school or faction. Not flattering, but also not inflammatory. Option four, the C word, cult. It's better with just a little bit of, you know, cult. Well, this word is almost always inflammatory, prompting either curiosity or outright hostility. It's a loaded word. It's best used with discretion and restraint. It can come across as mean-spirited and harsh and intended to cause injury, kind of a verbal weapon. And bear in mind that popular everyday use of the word cult is largely based on two perceptions, deviance and harm. Deviance as in, this group looks offbeat, unconventional, a little unsettling, maybe creepy. Harm. This group is capable of dangerous things, and I don't want to be there when they happen. So, just to help you imagine this a little better, in relation to using cult to describe Adventism, picture this conversation with me and a skeptical Christian. Me. Most people don't know this, but the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a cult. Skeptic. What do you mean? Like the Manson family? Like Jonestown? The Order of the Solar Temple? Branch Davidians? Shinrikyo? Nexium? Me. Well, no. I mean, they're not brainwashing their followers into killing people or committing suicide or branding their women with a hot iron. Skeptic. Oh, so like Adventists are what? Like the Mormons or the Jehovah's Witnesses? Me. Well, not exactly like them. You see, those groups are kind of authoritarian, and you can tell right away that their doctrines are really kind of weird and extreme, you know, like polytheism and special underwear and forbidding blood transfusions and voting. Skeptic. Okay, but what do you mean? A quick bit, if I can spit it out, of historical background. So, none of you is probably, very few of you are probably old enough to remember these things, but 60 or so years ago, prominent evangelical authors and theologians easily applied the label cult to Seventh-day Adventism. Men like Gordon Lewis, Lewis Talbot, Anthony Hokima, Jan Carl van Balen, Harold Lindzel, Donald Gray Barnhouse, once upon a time. But prominent evangelical authors and theologians today are often unwilling to use the cult label, and these include James Beverly, who stated in his massive book on new religions that Seventh-day Adventism is in essential agreement with evangelical Christianity. Wayne House, Edmund Gruss, Ruth Tucker, who noted cultic characteristics of Adventism in her book, Another Gospel, good for you. Norman Geisler and Ron Rhodes, who describe Adventism as aberrant in their book, When Cultists Ask. Walter Martin, who called Seventh-day Adventism a puzzle in Kingdom of the Cults. Look, Walter Martin is the elephant in this room, for this talk at least. Yes, I did work with him. I worked under him for 9 years. I was with him in the United States, in Kenya, and Brazil. So, you know, we need to be careful about presuming what persons long dead would do or say if they were alive today. But and people take that liberty with Walter Martin often. It's kind of annoying. But Walter Martin was the giant speed bump for the word cult being applied to Adventism. Because I almost brought my copy to wave it around. He said that, you know, Seventh-day Adventism was not to be regarded as a cult because he believed what those Adventists told him. And for many people, Kingdom of the Cults, this fat book that's in now, what, its 1,000,000th printing, is seen by people as the final word. Walter Martin was the guy who knew. This is the book. We can, I don't know more than Walter Martin, so the matter is settled, right? Now, to his credit, Walter Martin's protege, Ken Samples of Reasons to Believe, writing in the Christian Research Journal, I encourage you to read everything that Ken writes about Adventism, but he said these three things, which I quite appreciate. Quote, it would appear that traditional Adventism is at least aberrant. Quote, traditional Adventism is theologically bankrupt. And, quote, if the traditional camp continues in its departure from questions on doctrine and in promoting Ellen White as the church's infallible interpreter, then they could, one day, be fully deserving of the title cult, as some Adventists recognize. So, that by way of background. Now, in my experience, dealing with a lot of people, I'll be very interested to know what Jim says. Evangelicals do tend to just compare Adventism with the big two cults, the 19th century American cults, Mormonism and Jehovah's Witnesses. But you've probably noticed that Adventists appear less exclusionary and cult-like for a variety of reasons, including ecumenical outreach. They're not so openly strident in denouncing other churches. Thousands of schools, which, by the way, non-Adventists can attend. Hospitals and clinics around the world, which non-Adventists can benefit from. Not to mention international relief work, thinking here of ADRA, and seemingly greater tolerance for internal dissent than these other two groups. And in all five categories, Adventism compares favorably with the Mormon Church, and even more favorably, by far, with the Jehovah's Witnesses, who are more clearly world-rejecting as an institution. So when considered next to its two closest competitors, Adventism seems less culty, you know? Have you noticed this? Now, many people, being good-hearted, in a sense, seem quite willing to give Adventists the benefit of the doubt, rather than to view them antagonistically. Especially since the church can be evasive and deceptive about what it really believes and what its history really was, and quite skillful in doublespeak and gaslighting uninformed inquirers. Although, this will interest you, in a widely quoted national survey, religion survey last year, among U.S. denominations, the SDA church was viewed unfavorably by the largest number of respondents. It's the YouGov poll. Look it up. So, cults. The more formal definitions of the word cult tend to focus on two areas, behavior and beliefs. Now, behavior takes us into the province of psychologists and sociologists. We're not going there tonight. Beliefs, however, take us into the realm of theology. Doctrinal orthodoxy and heresy. How should we understand these words, orthodoxy and heresy? How many of you were here in 2015? Anyone, anyone? A few of you, yes? Of course, the Careys were here. The Grangers were here. The Takers were here. Rob Bowman was here. Dr. Robert M. Bowman, Jr., now president of the Institute for Religious Research. I love his book, Orthodoxy and Heresy, and he makes a lot of things wonderfully clear. This is how he defines cult, quote, "A religious group originating as a heretical sect and maintaining fervent commitment to heresy." What is his definition of heresy? Quote, "A teaching which opposes the essentials of the Christian faith, so that true Christians must divide themselves from those who hold it." Now, if those are our operational definitions of cult and heresy, then Seventh-day Adventism as a theological system is a clear candidate. But again, to repeat, using the word cult to label Adventism can easily alienate both of the audiences we ostensibly want to persuade. So, if we're convinced that Seventh-day Adventism needs to be understood, answered, and opposed, how do we best persuade skeptical Christians of the seriousness of this problem? No, I know I'm coming along here after the tinkers have been knocking themselves out doing that very thing. But give me a chance. I propose that instead of a label that's polarizing, we use a simple description that's clarifying and that sets up a simple, memorable, biblical explanation. Something strong, succinct, sufficient, not sensationalistic, memorable, relatively easy for the average person to explain, easy to support from authoritative Adventist sources, mainly Ellen White herself. Something that anticipates objections and is therefore more difficult for Adventists to simply dismiss or deny. So let me propose a better way of labeling the problem. Seventh-day Adventism is a clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. So just think about that. A clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. That's accurate, doesn't punch the usual buttons, but stay with me. There's a companion argument that I'd like you to evaluate for me, right? This is a work in progress. So in almost every book, the New Testament warns Christians again and again about false prophets, false Christs, and false gospels. Yes? Yes? Yes, you've seen it, right? You don't need me to proof text that. You know it, you're persuaded. So, Seventh-day Adventism is so dangerous because it comes with all three. A false prophet, a false Jesus, and an impossible salvation. Amen. Now, I think if you share those three points with any concerned Christian or potentially concerned Christian, you will probably have their attention. And they will know in what areas they need to be wary of Seventh-day Adventism. So, a proposed approach. I've got these three points. Each of them has two or three sub-points each. I'll illustrate them with a few examples, and there's a bit of overlap from one point to the next. Number one, Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false prophet. By the way, a 70-year career characterized by error, deception, and confusion. While claiming divine authority, Ellen White, three sub-points, contradicted the Bible in harmful ways. Contradicted the Bible in harmful ways, not trivial ways, harmful ways. Undermining essential doctrines like the Trinity, person and work of Christ, salvation. Second, she added to the Bible in harmful ways. She fictionalized the life of Jesus. She created detailed imaginary events, invented commandments, changed the Bible's meaning again and again. And third, she made false prophecies, something that the Bible specifically makes a test for prophets. That's point number one. Point number two, Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false Jesus. What does it teach about his nature and identity? Well, confusion and mixed messages about the doctrine of the Trinity since day one. Day one. Most SDA founders were Arians who openly rejected Jesus as God. Ellen White described Jesus and Satan as being almost equals until the Father promoted Jesus in a special heavenly ceremony. She wrote that Jesus took upon himself, recite it with me, fallen, suffering human nature, degraded and defiled by sin. And Adventism teaches that Michael the Archangel is, quote, none other than Christ. Thank you, Kaspars, for that wonderful article last week. A false Jesus, not only concerning his nature and identity, but also his work on our behalf. Ellen White claimed that Jesus had to plead with God the Father three times for permission to become the Savior. Jesus' ministry on earth was as our example to show humanity that all Ten Commandments could be kept. Jesus doubted that God the Father would even accept his sacrifice on the cross. Jesus didn't even know whether he would rise from the dead. And by the way, his atonement is incomplete, as we'll see more on this in a moment. Seventh-day Adventism offers us a false Jesus. And third, an impossible salvation. Ellen White stated repeatedly and in various ways that our eternal salvation depends on our personal worthiness. That makes it mission impossible. That includes keeping Ellen's own invented requirements for salvation, like abstaining from drinking tea and coffee. Also, that our salvation is impossible because Jesus' atonement for our sins is incomplete. An imaginary investigative judgment began in 1844, and it's still going on. None of us can know when this process will be finished or who will be saved. And guys, skeptical friends, imagine that you are my skeptical friends, Adventism doesn't exist apart from this investigative judgment. The church vanishes without the investigative judgment. Now, of course, these three major points don't exhaust what is theologically wrong with Adventism, right? They're just the tip of the iceberg. But I believe they are potentially quite sufficient to drive home the point that Adventist teaching is deeply heretical, and yes, here it comes, cultic. Now, why use Ellen White as the launch point of this three-step explanation? Because in actual Adventist practice, the Bible is subordinate to Ellen. In her way, Ellen G. White is just as much a false prophet as Charles Taze Russell and Joseph Smith, even if their errors were not identical. The gravity of their sin is at least equal. Now, for my skeptical friends who might be wondering why this approach is being taken. How authoritative and influential is Adventism's false prophet? Well, according to Ellen herself, well, she repeatedly and in various ways described her own work and writings as being divinely inspired, basically infallible, and not subject to challenge. And according to Ted Wilson, the current General Conference president of the SDA Church worldwide, entering his 13th year in office, Ellen is both essential and unassailable. I quote from his Sabbath sermon at the October 2021 annual council meetings, quote, "The spirit of prophecy is absolutely reliable and is to be believed and accepted in its entirety. Ellen White was absolutely a prophet of God, and her ministry, including strong messages from the throne room of God about apocalyptic prophecy and instruction, are for all time." Close quote. Now, maybe you've heard about the Great Controversy Project 2.0, right? Last May, Great Controversy was voted by the SDA General Conference Executive Committee as the missionary book of the year, with plans to distribute millions and millions more copies this year and next year in preparation for Jesus' return. This is Ted Wilson describing the Great Controversy. Quote, it was inspired and guided by the Holy Spirit. Quote, I believe every word in this book. Quote, in fact, we're even talking about distributing up to 1 billion copies of this book. That was in 2021. So this is not a peripheral issue. There is no Adventism apart from its false prophet, Ellen G. White, as you know. So, in closing, we can sum up the core of Adventism's error in 3 points, and by doing so, we may be able to more easily warn and equip many Christians who might otherwise might not grasp the urgency of resisting Adventist proselytizing and evangelizing Adventists who are enslaved by error. Bottom line, Seventh-day Adventism is a clever and dangerous spiritual counterfeit. And it's radically wrong about 3 things that the Bible specifically identifies as marks of a dangerous spiritual counterfeit. Let's pray. Merciful, gracious God, we thank you for revealing yourself in your word, for being at work in our world through the Holy Spirit, and for calling us unto yourself. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to share your love with Adventists in gentleness and truth, but also, Lord, to alert our brothers and sisters in Christ that there is a work to be done to show your love, your truth, to those who are enslaved by Ellen and her Adventism. Father, give us the means, give us the courage, give us the stamina to do this faithfully in the time that remains. We worship you in Jesus' name.
Already see, we're going to have a lot in common to share our thoughts on Adventism. But I do want to explain to you first. First of all, my name's Jim. Those of you, I hopefully, you know, some of you, I think have seen some of my videos that I've done. But I want to explain to you, how did I wind up here in this space? You know, I remember the first conference I came to. I knew it was going to be funny when I'm coming here, because I know I'm the outside guy. I don't know anybody here. And I walk in the door, and I remember meeting people, and they would come up to me and they go, how long you been out? And I say, never was in. And then the response usually went something like this, what are you doing here? And I would say something like this. And this is what actually happened. I was literally sitting at my computer desk and wanting to do something more in terms of using my gifts that I've been gifted with for the Lord and reaching the lost. Now, here's where I started. You heard from my bio earlier. 1990 is when I became a Christian. Right, basically when I left the U.S. Army. I was in the 82nd Airborne in the U.S. Army. So I left the military, became a Christian. I was a Christian for about 6 months, I remember. And I remember at that time I was using my GI Bill and I'm going to school. And I'm literally sitting on my floor doing homework, because that's what you do when you go to school part-time. You work all day and you go to school at night. And then I hear this on my door and I look up and there's two young, nicely dressed young ladies on my door. I went, it's Jehovah's Witnesses. I thought, this is great, because they come to me. I don't even have to go to them. And then as soon as I got up and I took a step, then you ever had that panic feeling? You just that cold? Because I started going, you don't even know what you believe. You just don't know anything. And that was true. I didn't. But But then I started studying the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. I still occasionally try to go out on the streets and witness to Jehovah's Witnesses. When they're standing in front of libraries and donut shops, they got their magazines. I love to walk up to them and, you know, try to get a conversation. It only goes once. They're getting harder to talk to. They really are over the years, I've noticed. As I was studying my apologetics with Jehovah's Witnesses, I remember one day I was in my library. I'd finished an apologetical book. At this time, I was riding the train to work every day. I love my train, riding the train. I don't do it anymore. But I put on my headset. I could tune out everybody, and I could just read as I'm going to and from work. Remember, I'm in my library, and I just looked up at my Quran on my top shelf, and I just felt like, you know, you've been ignoring that religion way too long. This was 8 months before September 11th. And I did a deep dive in Islam 8 months before September 11th. And I remember when it happened, I went, I know why it happened. I've been studying the Hadiths, the Quran, I get it. At that time, I go to mosque on Fridays and greet the Muslims when they come out of prayer. And I have Qurans and I got Hadiths with me. And I talk to them and share the real Injil, the real gospel with the Muslims. Well, my work schedule changed and I can't go to the mosque anymore, right, on Fridays. Jehovah's Witnesses won't talk to me. I mean, literally, they see my truck and they run. They won't talk to me. I mean, they're really getting harder to talk to. And I remember sitting at my desk going, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And I go online. I go, yeah, YouTube. And I know some of the premier Muslim apologists. I'm still engaged with my Muslim ministry. I mean, I just talked to our leader yesterday. And they're already doing a good job. I was like, why am I going to go there? They're already there. And I know others doing Jehovah's Witness stuff. And I know some of those ministries have been there for a long time. They're already there. I thought, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to do what everyone else is doing. And then I looked around and I go, Adventist. And I started looking around and I go, you know, there are some people here. It's true, there are. But there's not as many. And the material that they have is not as in-depth and as deep as... I mean, My library is, I don't know, roughly probably 5,000 books. And I've got a lot of, I own many, many, many. If you're going to deal with Jehovah's Witnesses, you have to deal with original literature. They don't take photocopies. So I got all their studies in the scriptures, millennial dawns, early golden ages, da, 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 and I deal with them. I love going out on the street, pulling out a magazine from, you know, 1920, saying, let's talk about Beth Serene, you know, which is a false prophecy from 1925. So I said, you know, I'll do an Adventist. And never even met an Adventist, by the way. Don't even know any Adventists. But I did order something that I had. Ordered this a long time ago. Because if you study the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, you are going to run into a guy named William Miller. Because Charles Taze Russell called William Miller Father Miller in the early Watchtower magazines. I knew all about William Miller and Second Day Adventism and Joshua Himes, and I knew all that stuff, but I didn't know much about Seventh Day Adventism. I knew a little bit, and I got on this guy's mailing list way back in the day. He has since passed away. I think it was Payson, Arizona. Leaves of Autumn Books. You ever heard of Leaves of Autumn Books, some of you? And he used to send out a list you could buy used books from. And I remember I got Spiritual Gifts, Volume 3 and Volume 4, Original Editions, 1864. In, I think it's Volume 3, is Ellen White's, air quote, famous quote on amalgamation of man and beast. Because here's what I know about false religions and their prophets. Their prophets will say the darndest things, and they'll put it in writing. And I learned this from the Jehovah's Witnesses, collect original material. And that's what I do. That's all I do. I don't quote books from other people. I don't quote other people. If I say this all the time. If I quote it, I own it. I'll show it to you. If I quote it, I own it. And so I had that. And I thought, I got to go to Adventist. And so I sat down on YouTube, started dialoguing Seventh-day Adventist. I didn't even have argument one about the Sabbath, right? The big beast in the room with Seventh-day Adventists. I didn't even know how their arguments. I didn't know nothing. Right? So I'm a blank slate running down this road. Showed up to my first conference. I remember sitting next to Dale Ratzlaff over here. had lunch with him the first day. And he looked at me too. He goes, "Well, what are you doing here?" I said, "Well, Dale, this is what I'm doing." He goes, "You got to understand the Sabbath. You better get that Sabbath thing down." He goes, "Because that's where they're going to go all the time." I said, "Yes, sir." You know, and I got his book, and, you know, Sabbath in Crisis. And I started reading his book. So that's what got me on this road. I've been on this road now about 4 years that I've been doing this. I dialogue Seventh-day Adventists. I deal with Seventh-day Adventists every day. About an hour or so a day, every day. Sometimes a little more than an hour, sometimes a little less than an hour, but every day I'm talking to Adventists. I'm in Central America, South America, Africa, Europe, the Middle East. This morning I was telling Debbie, I was posting a comment in Portuguese on a Portuguese channel exposing Seventh-day Adventism. Google Translate's wonderful. I've dialogued Seventh-day Adventists in Spanish, Slovakian, Portuguese, and English. And you know what I find? They're all the same. A Slovakian Seventh-day Adventist gives me all the same proof texts. Well, you know, Jesus said, keep John 14:15, right? Keep the commandments. And it's like, oh, it's Slovakian and Spanish. And they all do the same thing. So my topic is, why worry about Seventh-day Adventists? And I agree a lot with what Paul said. First of all, I don't use the word cult when I dialogue Seventh-day Adventists. Because I saw early on when others were doing it, it would just, they would just screw themselves into the ceiling, run around the room with their hands in the air going, "We're not a cult, we're not a cult." And I quickly learned that, yeah, that, it's inflammatory. And it's like, you know what? I don't want to talk to you whether you're a cult or not. I'm not interested in that. Here's what I will say, you're not Christian. That's what I'm interested in. And why would I say that? Because you got a different Jesus and you got a different gospel. And that's what I talk about. I bang that single point on my keyboard every day. That's all I want to talk about. Who's your Jesus in Seventh-day Adventism? And your three angels' messages. And I say all the time, and I say, yeah, your three, and of course when I say that to Seventh-day Adventists, the three angels' messages go, "Well, yeah, just go to Revelation 14:6. It's right there. See, everlasting gospel." And I say, but do you realize that each of your angels has gospel messages? What are those gospel messages of your angels? What's the gospel message of the first angel, the second angel, the third angel? Why don't you show me, can you show me that in the Bible? And then the conversation goes dark because they can't. And I say, well, you know, I can show you where they come from. Here's my two sources. I collect their books. I love collecting their books. All right, this is my working copy of my 28 Beliefs book with all my notes in it. I got another one, a clean one I use for pictures. And I love this one, Discipleship Handbook. And I quote these all. Matter of fact, this book here is just a gem. If you read the preface of this book, this is a GC, General Conference published book. They tell you these GC guys that put this book together said they did this under the direction of the Holy Spirit. It's in the preface. And if you don't believe me, you can talk to me after. I'll show you. I got it underlined. I go, ooh, I got something here that came from God. Right here. All right. And so when you talk to me about the three angels' messages and what each gospel angel is saying, I put these two together. Because in this 28 Beliefs book, I got the chapter on the remnant. And then on page 196, which because I quote it all the time, page 196 to 201, it's the mission of the remnant. Guess what the mission of the remnant is? Preach the three angels' gospel. And then they define what each of the angels say. One of my favorite ones is, speaking of the third angel. One of the messages is a message about Darwinism. Call an alert to, you know, Darwinism and evolution. I love, I ask the Adventists, I go, oh, so that's one of your gospel messages, Darwin. Can you show me where any apostle taught about Darwinism in the Bible? Right, because then you know where I'm going right after that with the Adventists. I'm going, do you know that if you preach a gospel other than the gospel that the apostle Paul taught and received from the risen Christ, Galatians 1 says you are twice cursed. I said, this now this is serious. And that's what I often tell them. You know, we may be having this exchange and going back and forth, and it may seem like linguistic, you know, gymnastics. I go, no, this is serious. You are preaching a message which the Bible says is cursed. I said, you ought to be concerned. I'm concerned enough to show this to you right now. Because I saw Adventists today saying, oh, no, we preach the gospel message of Paul. I went, no, you don't. No, you don't. I take them to the, I go, what's the mission of the remnant? Page 196 to 201 in the 28 Beliefs book. Everlasting gospel. And where am I going to find the definition of that? I won't find it in the Bible. And I talk a lot about their Jesus. I say, who is your Jesus? By the way, most of the Christian church doesn't even recognize this fact, that there are other Jesuses out there. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. The Apostle Paul is with the Corinthian church, fretting over them, going, ah, I'm afraid if someone comes and preaches a Jesus other than the one that you've been taught, you're going to just put up with it. And I say, oh yeah, there's all kinds of Jesuses out there. I can talk about who the Jesus of the Jehovah's Witness, right, the Mormons, the Christians, and on and on and on. And I say, and who's your Jesus, Seventh-day Adventist? I mean, if I almost say, you know, if I was to pick him up and turn him over, it would say made in 1844. Yeah. Right? Because he was made in 1844. I said, you have a different Jesus. You got a Jesus dressed as a Levitical priest in the temple right now, doing the investigative judgment with sins of people, sins in heaven, and forgiving sins in a second phase of atonement. I say, how is Jesus a Levitical priest? And of course, right, he's of the tribe of Judah. He's not Levi. But I find all the pictures of, you know, Christ, and you've all seen them, you formers, you already know. They got Jesus dressed up with, right, the fancy Levitical garb on. And I say, you got a different Christ. This is serious. These are the two issues I bang on all the time. I want the Adventists to know you got a different Jesus and you got a different gospel. And if you have those things and those two things are different, you're in trouble. Matthew chapter 7, Christ said what? Not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter the kingdom of heaven. I mean, if you read that, Matthew 7, 21 through 23, there are people there who clearly think they're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. And I point that out to Adventists all the time. I go, you may think you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. I said, but if you have a different Christ and you have a different gospel, I said, you're in trouble. I present this message probably near every day, multiple times a day, to Adventists all around the world. And I mean, sometimes I walk away from my keyboard and I go, oh. Because I'm worried for them, and I'm distressed because sometimes they'll totally reject what I say. I said, that's fine, you know, right? We don't force people to believe anything. I'm presenting this to you though, but they'll reject it. And sometimes I just feel, I go, wow. I go talk to my wife, and I go, oh, I just had this conversation with this guy, and it went like this, and I presented this, and he's just totally. And I was like, wow. I go, this is serious business. And they reject it all the time. Now, I love what Greg Kokel says. Sometimes if all your mission is, if you can put a rock in someone's shoe, it's a little irritant. I look at a lot of what I do as doing just that. I am putting rocks in people's shoe. As an irritant. So why worry about Adventists? It is clearly everything, like Paul said, they got a false Jesus and they got a false gospel. But they won't tell you that at first. I've dealt a lot with Adventists. They love to say, well, you know, we believe in Jesus like you believe in Jesus. Right? Sola Scriptura. I just did a video on Sola Scriptura. Probably, I think it's still out there now. I think it's the current one. The January 2023, because I subscribe to the Adventist Review magazine. I love it. I love telling Adventists I subscribe to your literature and send it to me. And I do. I get their magazine, I read your magazine. And when I find something of noteworthy, then I'm going to make a video on it. And I made a video of the January 2023 magazine. Because I opened up their magazine. And as I do all that, I'm looking at it and I go, oh, we got a reading plan. A Bible reading plan for 2023. I go, oh, I start looking at it and I go, and out in the margin, like for January 1st, it just says DA and some pages. Desire of the Ages. I forget what the acronym is again for Christ Object Lessons, but that's out there too. And then they had Bible verse, and then they had Bible day. So just in the first week of January, like three or four of the days were just DA days. And like two or three days were just Bible days. And I thought, nah, I'm going to sniff this one out. I'm going to look at this. Here's the grand result. I have Desire of the Ages and Christ Object Lessons in PDF. I dumped those into Microsoft Word. I was able through the use of, you know, wild cards and macros, pull out all words that are not readable words. Chapter headings, page numbers. I just want pure reading text. Because in 2023, at Seventh-day Adventists, are going to read Desire of the Ages and Christ Object Lessons and the four Gospels. The four Gospels in the KJV translation are 82,600 words. Desire of the Ages, and hold on to your seats. Desire of the Ages and Christ Object Lessons are 393,916 words. Wow. And I go to my Adventist friends, sola what? Sola Ellen is what I say a lot to them. Sola Ellen. 393,916 Ellen White words you will read as an Adventist if you follow this plan in 2023 in 82,600 words of just the four Gospels. Oh, yeah. It's sola, no, they love to say sola scriptura. Oh, they do. And, you know, some of them are just losing their mind in the comments on this video because I just say, hey, it is what it is. The facts are the facts. And in the video, I hold up the Ellen White books, the Desire of the Ages and Christ Object Lessons, and I put the Bible underneath it to show subservient. I said, this is what you're doing. You're placing the words of your prophet above the word of God. And that's what they do in Seventh-day Adventists. I like when you mention cults. Like I said, I stay away from it. Did you know that you're a cult? Adventists love to call all kinds of people cults. First of all, I went to the Adventist archive site and downloaded everything I could absolutely download in PDF. I forget what it is now, something like 7,000 or 8,000 Review and Heralds going back to the 1850s. I downloaded those one at a time. I got them all. Signs of the Times, the Health Reformer, and I downloaded everything I can. Everything. I estimate I got somewhere in the neighborhood 20 plus thousand magazines from their website. Plus, I downloaded all the books. And with Adobe Acrobat, I can do searches. And so, here's what I also I noted before I'll talk to you about cults. And the problem I see with Seventh-day Adventists is, as I study Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons and other groups, there have been great men and women of God who have written books and research on these cult groups. And really your task, if you want to witness to Jehovah's Witness, your hardest task is going to be, how do I wade through all the Christian literature that's been written out there about them so I can find, you know, some good, you know, research that'll get me started. And once you find that, it's really just a matter of simple fact of reading, you know, perhaps this one, two, or three apologetical books going, oh, okay, I see what the problems are. Bible, you're off and running. It doesn't work like that in Adventism. Not at all. You don't have that depth and volume of literature these other groups have. I noticed it right off the bat. One of my favorite books I use in Jehovah's Witness ministry to help me get my feet on the ground and pointing in the right direction was a book by a guy named David Reed called Index to Watchtower Errors. And in that book, it's just all these lists of all these Watchtower, Golden Age, Constellation magazines, and all the silly nonsense things and unbiblical things that they've said, you know, for decades. What a resource. And I thought, I want that in Adventism. I did find a small book by Mark Martin, a little small paperback. And but it's like nowhere near the volume of the David Reed book. So I've been making my own index to errors. My Microsoft Word file now is in excess of 300 pages. So I do searches all the time in those PDFs that I told you about. One of the searches I did was cults. Cult and cults. I said, show me all instances of those two words in all Adventist magazine. And sometimes it takes me days to go through this stuff. And so you know what I found? You're a cult. Oh, they hate to be called a cult. They call everybody under the sun a cult. And I documented all of that. I mean, whether you're a Baha'i, you're a Christian Science, you're a you know, Jehovah Witness, et cetera, they call all kinds of people a cult. So I think it's funny because they just literally will lose their mind if you call them a cult. But oh, they'll call you a cult in a minute. But I love it because I say this to Adventists all the time. I go, well, you call evangelical Christians a cult. They say, no, we don't. I go, oh yeah, you do. Yeah. September 9th, 1999, page 10. Review and Herald magazine. Listen to this. So this is the fall of the communists here. And I quote, when the communist regime collapsed in 1991, it left a spiritual vacuum that a variety of eager missionaries and cult followers rushed in. Who rushed in? Cult followers. Let's identify these cults. Hare Krishnas could be seen parading Novitsky Prospect in their monk-like garbs. Jehovah Witnesses crusaded with their literatures, and evangelical Protestants swept through the cities with their soul-winning efforts. There's the cults. Hare Krishnas, Jehovah Witnesses, and evangelical Christians. What I also think was funny, too, by the way, when I did that cult search, and when you were talking, I remember and I wrote it down, I found a quote from 1984, where they were talking, this one Adventist scholar says, please don't ever produce our own Bible. The minute we produce our own Bible, people are going to call us a cult. 1984. What'd they do 10 years after that? The Clear Word Bible. So sometimes I'll use that in my comments on Adventists. I say, y'all just called yourself a cult. I'll give the quote from the scholar from 1984, and then I'll say, here's Jack Blanco's work in 1994. You know, you call yourself a cult. Another quote I would like, speaking of Ellen White, and this is a quote that I found fairly recently. One of the biggest things, I think, in Adventism is the atonement of Christ. It's huge. I quote this book all the time. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357. I can almost quote you what Ellen White says on that page because I use the quote all the time. Christ did not die on the cross to cancel out sin. Sin would be dealt with in the sanctuary. All right. And I find that same kind of quote in Adventist literature over and over and over. Christ didn't die on the cross. I mean, to me, that's case number one. When I talk to an Adventist, by the way, Adventists love to call me brother. All the time in the comments. Hey, brother, don't be so harsh on us or don't say these bad things. I never let that comment go, ever. I say, sorry, we are not brothers in Christ. We are brothers in Adam, but we are not brothers in Christ. The reason why that we are not brothers in Christ is because if you are a 28 belief-believing Adventist, and you've been baptized, here's the current church manual, which is, as I understand, is going to be changing soon, because I read the conference reports, is going to be changing. The church manual here, on page 46, so I think I got tabbed, so 13 baptismal vows. You've taken a vow to Ellen White. I think it's vow number 8. And I said, and in this book, not only does Ellen White have her own chapter, Spirit of Prophecy, but chapter 24, the Investigative Judgment, the Sanctuary. And what does it say in the upper part of the paragraph? That Christ is engaging in his second phase of atonement. Where does the Bible talk about a multi-phase atonement? It doesn't. I share this with Adventists all the time. Now I don't know what's going on in Adventism. Maybe it's ignorance of what the Adventism teaches, but I find that that doctrine right there, because I ask Adventists all the time, did Jesus die on the cross for your sins? And probably 90% of the Adventists will say, oh yeah, absolutely. I go, uh-uh, sorry, according to your prophet. And then I'll send them that Ellen White quote, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 357. And guess what the Adventist does? He falls backwards and says, whoa, let me go to your church and get baptized, right? Yeah. You know what they do? And I've seen this with Jehovah's Witnesses on other issues. They do the same thing. They start defending Ellen White. I say, whoa, wait a minute. You just told me you didn't, this is what you believe, and you didn't know this existed, and now I give you the quote, and all of a sudden you act like you know and it exists, and you start defending Ellen White. That's why we need to worry about Seventh-day Adventists. Even these liberal that we often talk about, Seventh-day Adventists, who maybe don't have these very staunch beliefs that some of these conservative Adventists have, when they're, I see this thing happen all the time. I'll present them with an actual belief from Ellen White that they said, well, I don't know nothing about that. And then I show it to them, they go, oh yeah, and then they start defending it. Every single time they do that. It's disturbing to a certain degree. All right, I'm gonna see if I can find one last quote here. If not, then we will we'll finish this up, because it's about that time. Oh yeah, by the way, I get called a Jesuit at least once a week. I love telling the Adventists. I say, oh yeah, I got my Jesuit robe hanging up behind me. It's just funny. It's like that's like the ultimate insult that they do. Anyway, let's see here. All right. I'll just end here on this one last note. Something that Adventists do, I think, to downplay Ellen White. They say, oh, don't get all spun up about Ellen White. She's just the lesser light pointing to the greater light. That's all. She's just pointing to the Bible. That's all she does. Well, first of all, anyone you probably already know, in my index that I have, what I call Index of Adventist Errors, you know, I've got probably dozens of quotes where she contradicts the Bible. But I want you guys to know this. That quote is actually, it's an insult to the God of the universe. An absolute insult. Because Ellen, in that quote, and I'm going to read the quote to you, in that quote, becomes the appointed hero of God. Because God can't get anybody to read his word. So he comes to Ellen and says, oh, Ellen, be my lesser light so you can point to the greater light. And you know what the greater light is? It's in her books. That's what the quote actually says. The quote is from January 20th, 1903, on page 15 of the Review and Herald magazine. January 20th, 1903, page 15. I'm going to read you the pertinent part of this quote. So when Adventists do this and try to downplay Ellen, I'm like, no, the effect is really something much opposite of that. It's really an elevation of her. And this is what it said. The Lord has sent his people much instruction, line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little. Little heed is given to the Bible. And the Lord has given a lesser light to lead men and women to a greater light. Little heed is paid attention to the Bible. So what's the Lord do? He comes to Ellen and says, Ellen, be my lesser light to point to the greater light. And then she goes on to say this, oh, how much good would be accomplished if the books, and by the way, if you read the whole quote, it's the big books, Patriarchs and Prophets, Great Controversy. If the books containing this light were read with a determination to carry out the principles they contain. So whenever I hear Adventists quote this lesser light, like, oh, you know, Ellen White, that's all she does. I go, no, you got to read the quote. You got to read the quote. She makes herself out to be the hero to rescue God because no one is paying attention to his word. Absolute insult. That's why I say it's an absolute insult to the true God of the universe. So anyway, I'm going to end right here. I think we're going to get set up for our panel. So thank you very much.
OK. Okay, we're ready to have our Q&A. So starting on my right, your left, Paul Carden, who I already introduced, then Colleen Tinker, my wife, and also editor and writer for Proclamation, Kaspars Oselins, he's been introduced. He's at Southern, not the Adventist Southern, the Baptist Southern Seminary as a professor there, and Martin Carey, who does a lot of writing on our blog and a lot of ministry work with us. He's on the board. Jim Baber, who you've just heard, and then Nikki Stevenson. So Nikki and Colleen are the two people that are on the Former Adventist podcast. So if you have questions related to the podcast, that would also be appropriate. They just went through the book of Daniel. Very brave thing. And guess where they're going next? Revelation. Yeah, they are taking a little break, but then to Revelation they will go. Okay, so I'm going to carry a mic around the room. If you have a question, just raise your hand. But I would like to ask. Let's see, who would I like to ask? Who would like to call Adventism a cult? After hearing what you heard.
Can I quote you? Richard leaned over to me while Paul was talking and said, "Let's not call Adventism a cult. Let's call it something a lot worse."
Yeah.
Identifying those three things is very significant, and calling it a spiritual counterfeit, I love that word counterfeit, because that means it's masquerading as something real.
I'm at a former Adventist church that left the faith and is out in Maryland, and I guess I ought to be careful, but I've never been careful, and they look at me as I'm making a big deal out of, but there are pastors that are ex-Adventists, and they list their resume about the 10 years where they were working as a pastor, and I'm horrified because they're now 10 years as a Christian pastor, and the people that their histories of college and theology professors, and they all put that in their resume and CV, and it's all put out, and the rest of the congregation, oh, this person has got so many years as a pastor, so, and there isn't a distinction, or they don't look at it and say, I don't want to talk about when I was doing the doctrines of demons. And so that point is, where do we as Christians point out for those, because they're, you know, they go every Sunday and they have the Christian concept, but they have this kind of CV that they don't acknowledge, and that's the piece that I think Christianity truly is ignorant. And they all sit and go, well, that's a very experienced pastor. He's been 30 years. And where does the apologist come at it and say, let's talk about what we did in seminaries at Adventism and what that is and who are the professors? I mean, you made a reference to your Southern missionary. Were you at Southern, or was it a Southern university, or when you were? Yes.
Southern, which is a Baptist seminary where I currently teach.
Yeah, but you made a reference to what you were taught. Or was that at Southern Baptist? So you didn't make a reference to an Adventist theologian?
No.
Okay.
Say, what would the apologists say? And we have two here, so...
There we go. Yeah, if I was to run into somebody that was boasting of their Adventist background, but yet in a church that's portraying itself to be Christian, I'd want to sit down and have a one-on-one. That's all. I mean, there's nothing wrong with, on one hand, saying this is my background, this is where I came from. And that's not in itself a problem, but if it's being used as a laudatory, saying, this is why I'm qualified to teach in this church, well, no, that's different. As opposed to saying, this is my background, and I've came out of it. And that, so, yeah, I would want to know the context in which it's being used, and then I would know what to do from there.
They don't say I come out of it. There isn't a distinction.
Well, then maybe they haven't come out of it.
I left it, and there's a lot of yeast, what I call it, from hell and other things. Yeah.
Here we have. Hello? We have a question over here.
My question is if any of you have confronted the Adventist with the Hebrew 1, chapter 1:1-3, that in the end time God spoke through his son, no one else, what was their answer?
That's something I use all the time, and they usually don't answer it. Adventists are famous for answering questions that have never been asked. Okay? I get that all the time. So I will use exactly, because the verses that you pointed out are fantastic. And I'll cite those verses, and they'll say, yeah, but Corinthians says that there's going to be the gift of prophecy, and Ellen White's a gift of prophecy. I said, no. You'll find myself going back around in a do loop. They won't answer it directly, even though you're absolutely right. It absolutely refutes the concept of Ellen White and her spiritual gift.
I think I recall somewhere a reference to her plagiarizing from the Bible and saying, in the least last days he's spoken through the testimony, something like that. Mm-hmm. So it's not just other Christians that can be plagiarized, but sometimes even Scripture itself, and it's co-opted for a different purpose.
Testimonies, volume 5.
Yes. Yeah. And that quote is used in the copy of their Seventh-day Adventist belief, the explanation of the fundamental beliefs. It's quite shocking to me that it's just out there, blatant, and as part of the defense of her gift.
Okay, we have a question back here.
Okay, I wanted to ask about, like, I guess the nature of Satan. So is he technically a sinner? That's the first question. And then the second one is, if hypothetically he repented, would he be forgiven?
Again? Oh, Satan.
Satan.
Well, there's not a well-developed theology of that in Adventism, but it's just hinted at. Do you have a...
Are you asking about what Adventists would say about this, or what biblical doctrine would say about this?
I think from a Christian standpoint, since...
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I quoted about what Jesus talked about, who Satan is, the father of lies. And of course, lying is definitely a sin. Regarding the second question about repenting, I think that's really interesting in my mind, because when Colleen talked about that issue, to my mind, that reveals a complete ignorance of what salvation is and what it required. And so basically what Adventists are saying when they say that there's some kind of theoretical possibility for Satan to be saved or repent is that the incarnation and Jesus' death on the cross for human beings is somehow secondary, because Jesus became a man in order to die for sinners who are human beings, not for fallen angels. Peter says that the fallen angels were judged immediately once they sinned and committed to chains of gloomy darkness. So God never sent a savior for angels, fallen angels, including Satan, which is amazing, even more so for us as believers, because we realize that God didn't have to come and send his son to save us as human beings.
Yeah. And Hebrews, I believe it's 1, might be 2, says that Jesus, it's not angels that Jesus helps, it's the sons of Abraham. And Jesus said the lake of fire was prepared for the devil and his angels.
Hey, I had a question about the, I'm new to Adventism, moved here as a student at Loma Linda, trying to engage this. Can you explain to me from a Adventist perspective what the investigative judgment is? I haven't gotten a good answer on this ever. And so if you could explain that from an Adventist perspective the best you can, and then specifically why in the Bible it's not true.
All right. And you know, and I'm sure, that, I mean, this is the biggest, deepest topic, so whatever I say, I'm probably going to leave some things out. Others can jump in, catch what I don't, but I'm going to try to at least hit the high points. So in 1844, you have this event taking place, right? You have a prophecy by William Miller, turns out to be false. And there's an attempt in Adventism to rescue a false prophet and false prophecy. A vision by Hiram Edson in a cornfield says, oh, I know what it is now. We are not expecting the actual physical return of Christ. It's going to be more of a spiritual return. He's going to go from the most holy to the holy apartment, and he's going to make this move. This is going to happen in the heavenlies. And this Christ, so that's why you probably heard me say that it's a different Christ. So that's why I'm saying, when I speak about this, I'm talking about a different Christ. This Christ now is in the heavenly sanctuary and dressed, as you probably heard me say if you were here, as a Levitical priest, because this goes back to Leviticus chapter 16, because they believe what's going on in this investigative judgment is a mere copy of the sanctuary service that we see in the book of Leviticus. And so what happens in Leviticus with the Levitical priest? They're sacrificing and atoning for sins. So they say, this Jesus in 1844 now is in an actual physical temple in heaven, dressed as a Levitical priest, is forgiving the sins of, and it can only be confessed sins, by the way. So you as an Adventist, you got to remember everything, which is troubling in itself. So he's only, by the way, the investigative judgment is a judgment of believers and believers only. It's not the non-believers. So it's a, Jesus is forgiving the sins of these believers who have confessed their sins, and that's the actual true atonement in Adventism. Of course, as an Adventist, right now you're in a state of probation until you have reached your investigative judgment, then it's final. Yeah, and it's a secret. You don't know when. So I know I kind of hit some high points, but I know there's all other kinds of detail others can fill in.
I taught through Leviticus this week with my students at Southern, and one of the things I wanted to point out to them, I didn't talk too much about Adventism, but I think this connects with this whole mess of doctrinal, you know, complex, and that is to say that the links between Leviticus and this eschatological, you know, end times investigative judgment are so overwrought that I think what's going on is they're completely misunderstanding the purpose of the Levitical system, and sometimes I think even evangelists can misunderstand that. I would submit to you that the sacrificial system was never designed to deal with moral guilt, even as a intermediary from the cross. It always describes unintentional sins and ceremonial violations, because all these ceremonial laws were designed as kind of sermon illustrations to point to the reality of what moral sin is like and how it defiles us. So they needed this tutor to teach them every day, all the time, about sin. Now, when you sacrifice an animal, the blood is never, there's no transfer of guilt from the worshiper to the animal, because you can never bring defiled blood into the tabernacle. You cannot do that. You must bring a perfect animal, and it must be blameless. So on the Day of Atonement, that's the only time when one of the goats does have guilt confessed onto it. But that's the goat that is sent out of the camp. It cannot go into the tabernacle. The one that is taken into the tabernacle is slaughtered, but there's no transfer of any guilt. So the whole analogy breaks down, and you can't take it over into any kind of eschatological significance. So I think it's important for us to understand our theology of Leviticus before we even get to any kind of investigative judgment.
And to tag team with Caspar's, I remember when I realized several years ago that blood never, ever defiles. And Ellen actually said that the sins of the saved, that Jesus is investigating up in heaven, are the guilt of the sins that the guilt of the sins that he is looking over have been transferred from the person who has confessed them to the have been carried from that person by Jesus's blood into heaven. Do you see what that does? It makes Jesus's blood the defiler of heaven. And so at the end of this investigative judgment, when all the confessed sins have been judged, deemed forgiven or not, because on the basis of whether you've remembered to confess them, that's what used to keep me awake as a teenager. Have I confessed every sin? Have I confessed? He places Jesus, the sins of the saved, of those who've really confessed their sins, he places those sins on Satan, who carries them into the lake of fire, who bears the final penalty. It completely flips. Jesus is the defiler and Satan is the cleanser.
Daniel's little.
Go ahead. I just wanted to add to that. We also have an issue with the fact that Jesus moved from the holy place to the most holy place because the most holy place is where Jesus is. He's in the presence of God. He has been raised to sit at the right hand of God. That's the most holy place. And they also have this physical temple, by the way, in the belt of Orion, if you want to look for it through a telescope. But I want to also tell you, as a Christian, Ellen White had a vision about this moment when Jesus went and followed the Father into the most holy place. And in this vision, he left his throne in the throne room, wherever he was, to go there. And the Christians who did not believe Ellen White and their teachings continued to pray, and their prayers ascended to that throne room where Satan now has snuck in and begun answering their prayers and deceiving them. So Christians are now praying to Satan, according to their prophet.
Okay, we have another question.
In Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers in the prophets in many portions and in many ways, in verse 2, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. Now, in Testimonies, volume 5, page 661, Ellen takes that on under the heading Influence of the Testimonies and Object of the Testimonies. She starts out with verse 1, but then by verse 2, she's inserting herself, if you will. And then she says, there was never a time when God instructed his people more earnestly than he instructs them now concerning his will and the course that he would have them pursue. And this is actually even the second time she did this. She did a little more boldly here, but she had done the same thing in volume 4 of the Testimonies, page 147, 148. And that was 1876. So she replaces Jesus in this stuff. And kind of replaces Jesus and the Holy Spirit, for that matter. That's a problem.
When the Seventh-day Adventists are confronted with the fact that there was no more veil, no more two rooms when Jesus died on the cross, how could they explain that he went from one room to the other and waited until 1844 to go from one to the other when there are no more two rooms? She is constantly contradicting the truth of the Bible. And when the Bible says that no one knows the time when the Lord will come, and she had vision from God that, oh, Miller was right, and then, oh, Miller made a mistake, and it's 1844, and then, no, something else happened. How do they respond to these obvious lies?
They can't. They don't. And if you push them hard enough with some of these logical holes in their teaching, they just get upset. They feel attacked and like you're bashing them because they don't know how to respond. But there's a lot of fear in questioning Adventism. So if somebody is coming to you with questions you can't answer, but you know that if you leave, you are apostate, you just kind of circle the wagons because it's scary to do anything else.
Okay, we have another question.
Can you comment on the issue of Ellen White and plagiarism? I've had a lot of Adventists defend her with arguments such as back then plagiarism didn't exist, so it was okay. But in order for us to kind of plant the seed or be that stone in the shoe, do you have some thoughts of things that we can use?
Yeah, first I can recommend an excellent YouTube channel. I'm sure some of you have already seen it, called Test the Prophet. Go look at Test the Prophet. First of all, there's a reason why you only see his hands in the video. I'm just saying. That's his area of expertise. He tackles plagiarism head on. But you're right. They'll make all that arguments that you just made. Well, it was acceptable back then. No, it wasn't, because Hoyson and Coynbee, who Ellen plagiarized from, were going to take her to court, but they settled out of court. So no, literary thievery is still literary thievery. Period. I was just watching it in Venice where they were trying to make a claim from the Book of Enoch and how it got copied in Revelation and say, oh, the Apostle John copied a book. I'm going to do a video on that coming up. But you're right. No, they make lots of leaps like that. They have to defend their prophet. But what I've noticed, too, about plagiarism, the answers and arguments, they've been changing over time. They keep throwing something against the wall, and it never sticks, and they switch to a different one. All you need, right, and you probably already know this, just get your Great Controversy, 1911 edition. Open it up. Got all the footnotes. You know, what compelled them to do that? You know, because she got caught and they knew they had to come clean.
And one more thing. It doesn't matter how precise the laws were. Plagiarism is plagiarism, theft is theft, but here's the deal. She would say, I was shown. So she not only took ideas, words, and concepts from other people, she attributed it to God. Now that's blasphemy.
Okay, we have another question here for Paul.
Paul, I'm going to read two verses, and my question has to do with the second verse. I read the first verse to a lot of my Adventist family and friends, but it's the second verse that I have a question I could use some help with. So this is from the second epistle of John, and it is verses 9 and 10. Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. Second verse, verse 10. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, do not receive him into your home nor greet him, for he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. My question is this: how do we evangelize to Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses in light of that verse? If you could just give some clarity on that, if that made sense.
I think so. And I'm quite sure Kaspars can do a much better job than I. My understanding is that this letter is written in a context where churches were not meeting in lovely buildings like this one, or cathedrals, or the kinds of separate places of worship established for that purpose that we might see today. Rather, people were meeting in homes, and people were traveling and needed a place to stay as they carried out their itinerant ministries. And so I think the place to begin in understanding the application of these two verses is there, that it was a different situation than we typically have today. That doesn't mean there's no principle to apply now, but that's one of the first things to grasp.
And Jehovah's Witnesses knock on your door?
Are you letting them use are you letting them use your house as a base of operations?
No.
If you're not, okay, then you're probably not violating,
okay,
the command. Fair enough.
Hello, I'm a non-former Adventist, and I was chatting with other non-former Adventists at my table about this, that one thing that's kind of appealing about Adventism is how they honor the Sabbath and they take it seriously, and sometimes it seems like the rest of us Christians don't really bother to rest. I know, like, my history going to church, you know, when I was going to church in Costa Mesa in Orange County, it's like go to church and then go to brunch and then go to Target, and it's just another day of the week. And so it's kind of nice that they're taking this rest seriously. And but then I see now that I know more about it, it's quite oppressive and all that. And I understand Hebrews and that our Sabbath rest is in the Lord, et cetera. But I'm just curious, like, practically, how as Christians do we look at Sabbath? Having a day of rest, and how ought we look at that? Because most of us probably don't work on Sunday, right? But it's not a sin. We know that it's not a sin if we do work on Sunday, but I don't know. I'm just curious, like, as a Christian, how should I think practically about Sabbath rest and that commandment?
This is an area where good Christians sometimes disagree on what is the relationship between the Lord's Day and the Old Covenant Sabbath. Most of us, I think, as former Adventists, would want to say that there's not a one-to-one or a direct relationship between the Lord's Day and the Old Covenant Sabbath. And I think that the letter to the Hebrews is pointing out that the fulfillment of the Old Covenant Sabbath is actually the rest that we achieve in Christ. So with that away, and if the Old Covenant as a covenant has truly passed, that means that we're left with understanding what New Testament believers did in terms of their practice, and we see that they did have a tradition of meeting on the first day of the week, which they called the Lord's Day, and in honor of Christ's resurrection. No, it didn't come with Constantine. And we do not see any explicit commands given to us as New Covenant believers about how we are to observe this day. We are encouraged to observe each day as we see fit, as the Lord prompts us in our consciences. And so I would say that although rest is a good thing, physical rest is obviously very good, and overworking is not, could be a sign of idolatry or other things. We need to be careful to not place particular burdens or commands upon other Christians which are not explicitly given to us in Scripture. So.
I'd like to piggyback with that. Romans 14 does definitely say, as Caspar's mentioned, that we observe or don't observe as we're convinced, and we do whatever we do to the Lord. The New Covenant is distinctly different. As I remember Richard pointing out some years ago, and it was such a profound thing when I heard him say it, that the New Covenant has a new remember. The Old Covenant had remember the Sabbath. It was the sign of the covenant, Exodus 31. In the New Covenant, Jesus at the Last Supper said to his disciples, "This is the cup of the New Covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." So there's a new remember for the New Covenant, and it's not associated with the shadow of a physical day. And I want to say this to people who have left Adventism. This is not a law, this is not a rule, but this is a principle that I see based on the fact that in Adventism, the seventh day was part of our salvation package. Now, we might not say as Adventists, oh yeah, we have to keep the Sabbath to be saved. I wouldn't have said that. However, had somebody asked me, would you lose salvation if you gave up the Sabbath? Now that would have been a harder question for me to answer. And Ellen said that it is the mark of those who will be saved when Jesus returns. Here's what we talk to people who leave Adventism. This is how we talk to them. Because it was an idol, because it carried God, so to speak, because we did not believe, based on all of the teachings of Ellen White and official Adventism, including their Sabbath school lessons, because they say that you aren't worshiping the true God unless you're worshiping on the seventh day, that is the message of their first angel, then Sabbath is part, Sabbath actually carries God for them. And if you're worshiping God on any day other than Sabbath, you're worshiping wrongly, and it's a false god. So when we leave and see that Jesus has fulfilled all that and has given us rest in him, for me and for most former Adventists I know, to try to keep going to church on Sabbath because it doesn't matter anyway, I'm just convinced and I'm comfortable, that is holding on to something that was for you an idol. And that Paul clearly talks against when he talked, for example, about not eating the food offered to idols. That the, you know, he talked to the pagan converts about that. So because it was an idol for us, it's something we have to give up. It was a huge deal for us to say, okay, I'm going to put my actions where my beliefs are, and I'm going to break the Sabbath because Jesus is all I need. And it was amazing how the first time Richard and I did that, we sensed the Lord with us every day of the week in a way we never could on Sabbath, and we tried.
This question is for Jim. As you've gone through your studies, and thank you, what has been the most shocking of, I mean, everyone is shocking, but what stands out the most to you?
I'm going to go with, I'll stick with the videos because I have a, we were talking earlier about the family abuse thing. That's shocking that I've noticed from a lot of you. Infidelity, family abuse, these family problems. In terms of my videos, I'll say these were something I didn't expect. When I did the Green Cord videos, as well as Ellen talking to dead James White in retirement years, the just blatant spiritism that is rampant in Adventism. Ellen White, I read another book, Victorian Women and the Theater of Trance. Ellen White was a Victorian woman engaged in theater of trance. She was a spirit medium. Little different than the other spirit mediums of her time, which would do shows and people would buy tickets for. She just went a religious route, essentially doing the same thing. So Ellen White is a true spirit medium. As I've said before, she's a woman of her time in her day as a spirit medium, engaged in spiritism and occultism, talking to dead James White, taking his advice, acting on that advice, getting her green cord from her, you know, angel, her guide, and then using that to stretch across her bosom to call for Christ. All that is just witchcraft and occultism. And I didn't expect quite all that, but that was indeed a surprise.
Hello. In your explanation, you said a sanctuary service, and that was one of the things that I've never heard before. And it seems like it's not the Day of Atonement, but it's also in the Holy of Holies, and I don't know what you're referring to there.
Now say that again. About
the sanctuary service, you mentioned that, and it's like distinct from the Day of Atonement, and I don't know about that.
So I would say in the seventh day, and you can tell me if I'm not getting your question right either. In the Seventh-day Adventist sanctuary, this sanctuary that is existing right now in a physical format, is Levitical priest Jesus atoning for sins. Okay? What that also means, what didn't happen, you could then ask the question, well, then what happened on the cross? My answer would be nothing. I mean, that's not what the scripture said. We can look at John 19:30. Jesus Christ said what at the very end? It is finished. But yeah, so in that sanctuary that's going on in heaven right now, that's what's going on, is that that Jesus is atoning for the sins of the believers and is doing that. So
it's one day that lasts over going on now 150 years.
Yes. So how do you bring a brainless person talking about the Sunday law to understand that that's a nonsense?
All right. Ellen White wrote a letter in 1902. Australia. Sunday law was going to happen. They were panicking in Australia. This isn't testimonies. And so what did Ellen White say? I'm just kind of paraphrasing. Go along, get along. Observe their Sunday law. Go to church. So the Sunday law is a big boogeyman that doesn't exist, in other words. I always tell Adventists when they bring up the Sunday law to me, I say, just follow Ellen White's letter from 1902. You're going to be fine. We're not going to run around and kill you. Ellen White said, go along to get along. And just do what she said. It's a letter from 1902. It was from Australia to her because they were concerned about the Sunday law. And she wrote back to him and told him how to deal with it.
Hi. So I've heard you mention that like Jesus dressed as a Levitical priest. Is that an Ellen G. White quote, or like where could I find that?
That is in all the art. And that's the thing that's so significant. They have their own art. It's not Christian art. I'll never forget walking through Loma Linda Hospital lobby with Paul Carden, Richard, and your representative from Africa. I think Rogers was with us. Or was it the Russian ones?
Or was it Pasha and
Pasha
Dima?
And Dima. Mm-hmm. And we're walking through Loma Linda Hospital several years ago, and Paul and the others would peer at the art on the walls. And, you know, they're the things we grew up with, you know. Jesus standing over the scientist, Jesus whispering to the doctor, Jesus standing beside the little girl sick in her bed, and it's like, oh, lovely Jesus, and they're peering at it, and Paul said, oh, this is not Christian art, and Richard and I were surprised, and we said, why not? And he said, well, it's a little hard to explain, but it's like, this is my buddy Jesus. Yeah. And he said, Christians don't see Jesus as a man that's my buddy Jesus. He's God. And then I began to realize that Adventist art has, from the cradle, taught Adventists how to think of Jesus without ever a word. And all the art includes the Levitical priest Jesus.
And they have to, is this on?
And they have to follow through with that. It's consistent with what Ellen White said. One of the favorite Adventist sayings is, as it is in the type, so it must be in the antitype. In other words, what was done there in the Old Testament tabernacle was an exact copy. They emphasize that endlessly. Ellen White emphasizes that endlessly in Patriarchs and Prophets and elsewhere. An exact copy of the heavenly sanctuary. So the Levitical priest wearing that garb and performing that ritual had to be copied in heaven by Jesus. So of course he would have to wear a Levitical priest's garb, the Urim and the Thummim and what have you. And of course that was based, like Kaspar's was mentioning earlier, they believed that the sins of the Israelites were being accumulated in the sanctuary all year long. Find that in scripture. Yes.
I got a question for the apologists. Why isn't any apologist interviewing Dr. Ben Carson on his membership as Seventh-day Adventist and how that impacts his worldview and dealing with the country, the United States, and what is the twist aspect that influences him, and I'm just off the top of my head, is how do you deal with Catholics, or how do you deal with others that might question your false prophet? Why isn't there a kind of census of, because he takes a lot of interviews, he talks to almost anybody, and I can't see why anybody on a podcast would say, let's get Dr. Carson in to talk about his belief.
Follow him, don't know what he's saying. Are you keeping up with Dr. Ben Carson?
I'm not keeping up with him, but you know, when you step into the realm of politics and it's another world, you know, and neither one of us would probably get an interview with them and be able to talk about what we'd like to talk about. So it just probably is not going to happen. And whether it doesn't matter what religion you are, it's just not going to happen. I'd like to, but.
My question is about in the context of the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. Because every time I see the word commandments in the New Testament, it's kind of problematic to me. And sometimes Paul will quote some of the Ten Commandments, although we know he never quotes the Sabbath. But like in Ephesians 6, he quotes the honoring the father and your mother, because that's the commandment that comes with a promise. So how do we understand that those commandments are no longer apply to Christians, but we see them quoted literally in the New Testament?
Paul says elsewhere that law is useful if it's used lawfully, right? So bottom line is that the Old Testament scriptures, which contain the Old Covenant, remain for Christians inerrant, true, and they give us wonderful picture of who God is. I think especially in today's culture, where we have twisted understandings of who God is and what His will is for humanity, it's very instructive to see what, for example, God says about male and female. There are very important things that God says in the Old Covenant and the Old Testament, so we still want to maintain all of that. The analogy I always use is that God's commands within a covenant might look very similar to His commands to another people group or another covenant context, but that doesn't mean that they are one and the same thing and that we can simply transfer over. The laws of the European Union will be very similar to the laws of the United States, and the reason they are similar is because they share a common Western legal tradition. That doesn't mean they're one and the same thing. And with the Old Covenant and what Paul says in the New Testament and how he's applying the Old Covenant, the continuity is the fact that God is the same, God's character has not changed, and so all those things are the same. But that doesn't allow us to say, therefore, that Christians are now under the Old Covenant or that they are obligated to keep the Old Covenant commands. I would say that.
Does that make sense? About, I had the same experience when I would read scripture and I would come across those words like commandments and I'd get tense. But sometimes just the context is going to inform you as you're reading that commandments doesn't always mean the Decalogue. You know, when Jesus sent his apostles out into the world, he said, "Go into the world teaching them all that I have commanded you." So we see a lot of the New Testament commandments are teachings of Christ that he gave to the apostles for us, and they're not the Decalogue. And it took me a long time to start pulling that apart, you know, or even for me, just seeing Jesus in the Gospels go into a synagogue, I'd panic. But there's context, historical context to that, and the genre of the book helps you too to understand what those commandments are that you're reading about. It takes a while, doesn't it?
To that, it's easy to think when you're first starting to unpack, it's easy to think that what you're hearing us say is, the law's done, you don't need it, now just go on and live as a Christian. But it's not exactly like that. Jesus said he didn't come to abolish the law, he came to fulfill it. So Israel was under the law as a shadow of what was coming. And when the one who was coming came, the law, as it says in Romans 3, 20 and 21, the law had testified of this righteousness of God that was apart from the law. So when this embodied righteousness came, when Jesus came, his life showed who he was because he fulfilled the law. He did everything the law pointed to. He fulfilled the prophets. So in the new covenant, we're not just going, oh, I'm done with the law. We're going, I have the fulfillment of the law. I have the living law now, and he's indwelling me. I have so much more than the law, and he holds me to a much higher standard.
I think, I think we'll cut the questions off now, and it's getting kind of late, but I would like for each of our panelists, our Q&A people, if you came across a Seventh-day Adventist, and there are a few right now online, what would, in one sentence, if you had one, just a moment to say something to them, what would you say? You want to start, Nikki?
Sentence?
Oh, maybe two.
You edit me. You know better.
Yeah, okay.
You know what? A little bit more than one, if that's okay. When I was leaving Adventism, I was terrified that we were apostatizing early on. And my husband said to me, Ellen White said everything she taught came from Scripture. So if all we do is read Scripture, it will lead us back to Ellen White. Or it will lead us completely away from her. And we repented of our Adventism. Just trust Scripture. If she's right, if she really only teaches from the Bible, you're okay just trusting Scripture.
So I would say to the Adventist, I would say your organization has totally deceived you. They've given you a false and fabricated Christ and a false and fabricated gospel. I know this not from being an Adventist, but I read your books. And I would implore you, look at the Word of God, Galatians 1, 6 through 9, about preaching a gospel other than the gospel the Apostle Paul got, which is 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. The Apostle Paul got that gospel message from the risen Christ, Galatians 1, 11. So I would implore you, look at those two things right there. Those are most important.
I would say to them that there's one important thing to know as a Christian. And I would encourage them to learn what the gospel really is. And that it's crystal clear. It's very straightforward and simple. You can read it there in 1 Corinthians 15. And I would encourage them to read that and study it for themselves without the help of some other prophet. And I'd be willing to talk about it further because Jesus is enough.
You know, I would encourage Adventists to pause when they're tempted to say, well, I believe that. I have the same view there, and to consider the terminology that we use in Christianity and to see whether or not terms like Jesus, gospel, God really mean the same thing to Christians and to Seventh-day Adventists. And it's very hard because I believe that Seventh-day Adventism has deceived its believers into thinking that the things they are following and believing in are essentially the same as those of broader Christianity. And so that is, it's going to be hard to untangle, but you need to stop and consider whether or not these really are the same thing. They may use the same words, but they're not necessarily the same thing.
I would want to say, ask God to show you what's real and true, and to open the Bible and ask him to show you how to read it. I don't really know any Adventists, and I'm talking from my experience, who really understand how to read the Bible from the perspective of understanding what the words say in the context, normal rules of grammar and vocabulary, understanding first of all what it said to the first audience, who were they, what would they have understood, observing word by word as you read, verb tenses, prepositions, what would they have understood, and realizing that application, what does this mean to me, is the very last thing you do. You don't open the Bible and say, what does this mean to me? You open the Bible and say, what does this say to the first reader? It can't mean anything different to you. Application may be somewhat different, but the meaning will not be. And the other thing I would say is, get a notebook and word for word, slowly, asking God to show you what he knows he wants you to know, copy the book of Galatians.
Test all things. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every appearance of evil.
Thank you so much, all of you, for your answers. And thank you, all of you who've been here today. We have another full day tomorrow, so please come back. Let's pray. Father, thank you for revealing yourself through your Son. Thank you for the simple gospel of trusting him. I pray that those who are not believers will believe. They will sense your call to the truth, to the true Jesus, the true gospel, your true word. Thank you for the work you're doing and will do. In Jesus' name, amen. See you tomorrow.